duty, honor, country. This three-word creed is the motto of the U.S. Military Academy. Since its founding in 1802, the Academy has fulfilled the same mission as it always has, to educate, train, and inspire the Corps of Cadets. The cadet whose record at West Point was almost as good as Douglas MacArthur's, Pete Dawkins. He came to the Academy primarily due to the influence of his high school football coach. He went on to become an All-American Heisman Trophy winner, first captain, finishing in the top 5% of his class, and was awarded a Rhodes Scholarship. He retired from the Army as a decorated general and ran for the United States Senate. He has since become a business executive in New York City. While Dawkins' life has transformed over the years, so has his alma mater. In 1976, women were admitted into the Academy for the first time. Today, women represent about 15% of the Corps of Cadets. Each year, there is one cadet, like Pete Dawkins, who stands out more than the others. And he is, this year, Andy Blickhahn.
So you're the number one cadet of your class?
Highest ranking cadet, yes, sir.
What does it mean to be here at West Point?
West Point means a lot of things. Having been a prior enlisted soldier and understanding the role of the officer in the Army, coming to West Point and seeing where we develop and build those officers, West Point is the backbone of what the officer corps does and stands for. Everything that everything you want your superior officer to stand for and everything that, you can hope to be is developed and instilled right here at West Point. So it's a really neat place to be, and it also carries the traditions of the Army. You can, why America exists, why the Army exists, what we stand for is all found right here at West Point. And the privilege of being at West Point is that all of America is represented here. So you've got all the purpose and you've got all the people, and it's just a great place to learn and develop, grow into being an Army officer.
When did you decide you wanted to come here?
When I was in Korea, I was on the DMZ, we were doing patrols, and I felt like I could make a greater contribution to the Army in the capacity of being an officer. A lot of my commanding officers were West Pointers, and through conversations and just some reflection, determined right then and there that if I was going to stick with the Army, which I really want to do, West Point was the place to be commissioned and to get to be an officer.
Does it happen frequently that men who are already, young men who are already in the Army, decide that they want to go back to West Point and become an officer?
That's right. About 10% of every class will have, about 10% of the class, each class of cadets will be.
Young men and women who are soldiers.
That's right. So it's quite a few, and they contribute quite a bit to the Corps. Having a little experience and a little bit of maturity, they level the playing field between the inexperienced and the overzealous.
What's the best moment you've had here?
You know, from a cadet standpoint, the greatest moment at West Point is when we beat Navy. It really is.
Right out of your heart, isn't it?
That's the right answer, Joe.
Yes.
Can I make a comment?
About beating Navy or about...
Well, that as well. But... you know, what Andy says is a very natural thing, and I think if you ask a number of cadets, they would say the same thing. And it's because West Point is about winning. When you really distill it down to the essence, it's an ethic and a culture and a life of winning, instilling that as the root goal. And sports in general, but football becomes such an integral, not only metaphor for that,
yes,
but the reality of it.
Even General MacArthur said that, you know, we call it sports the field of friendly strife. The spirit, the warrior ethos, the power of Army teams is what drives us here. If you look for a wartime mission for the Corps of Cadets, it's our sports teams. It's how we express ourselves, our vigor, and the focus on Navy and the power that holds inside of that sports context, that's our battle, that's our war. So
has anything in terms of sense of mission, sense of pride, sense of commitment changed since the tragedy of September 11th?
I wouldn't say that fundamentally any of those things have changed, because they were always here. You come here for all of those reasons, but what those events did for us was solidify our commitment, our resolve to not bend and to not be weary in our walk to become commissioned officers. this place did stiffen up. Everyone got a little bit more serious. I think there's a lot of reflection going on. But those were all there before. Cadets have all those qualities, and I think it just brought it out to the surface, and we had to deal with it. But I definitely say that the Corps is resolved and committed. I've seen a lot of great attitude changes come about, and everyone just stands a little straighter, understands that they've got a little bit more purpose to what we're doing now.
Who are your heroes?
My heroes are the soldiers that have gone before.
The men that have walked on these grounds?
That's right. You can't walk anywhere at West Point and not be encouraged and motivated by the men who've held these positions and walked here before. They're really our heroes. We assess and look back at history. We use that as a start point for where we want to take our lives and take the country. And West Point is just a great place to reflect and see those guys. Just amazing people. It's kind of neat to think about that and just look around and understand.
You are walking in giant footsteps here.
I can't even feel half the toes of my position. That's true.
Will you make the Army your life, your career?
It already is.
You have commitment of 5 years.
Right.
So if I come looking for you in 10 years, I'll still find you in the Army as far as you can tell today.
That's right, sir. I'm in kind of a unique position. I've got 8 years under my belt. This summer marks my eighth year anniversary of service to the Army. So the way I look at it, I've already made it a career. It's where I want to be. It's what I want to do. Hopefully, 20 years from now, you'll see me still walk around wearing brass on my shoulders, proud as can be, trying to lead some soldiers.
This is what it's about, isn't it, Pete?
Every bit of what it's about. What's exciting for an old soldier like me, frankly, is to see that the kind of enthusiasm, it's not a dour sense of duty. It's a exuberant sense of opportunity.
And mission.
And that it's still here and stronger than ever. It's a good spirit.
There is a statue here of Sylvanus.
Sylvanus there.
And he was, in a sense, the father of West Point.
Sylvanus Thayer, who'd been one of the first graduates of West Point, was picked to come and create what has become the modern military academy.
I'm often fascinated by this question, and I'm sure Pete's thought about this too. Can you make leaders? Can you, or are the truly best leaders have something that you found in listening to that voice of MacArthur? You know, you had some sense that MacArthur was born with some of those skills that made him a great leader. How much of this is something you learn that becomes part of an institution's mission? And how much of it is something to do with attracting the kind of person to this place and you would just enhance their skills?
I think one of the greatest things that we accomplish here at West Point is pulling everybody in, the general larger body of cadets. And if you identify that, if you recognize your needs as a follower, the true purpose of that leader is to meet the needs of those followers and accomplish a mission. And once everyone recognizes that we've all got those same needs and I've got an ability to meet those needs for my subordinates, they can then realize, yeah, I can be a leader and I can go on with this. I do think there are those that are, they've got the traits, you know, some kind of a skill or an ability that sets them above.
Sort of the right stuff or an X factor or something.
That's right. And they will continue to excel. They'll continue to be the Pete Dawkins and the Douglas MacArthurs of the world. But what we do here is provide, you know, we need to, every platoon needs a platoon leader and every company needs a company commander. And to meet that need, we do a great job of showing everybody they've got those skills and abilities inside of them, how to recognize those and how to go on and be a leader.
The military is very clear that command is something granted to you by your superior authorities. And leadership is something you earn from the people whom
that
you lead.
Yes.
And that understanding that distinction and realizing that you must both be an effective commander and a powerful leader is one of the most important things, I think, for cadets to learn from this place.
Turning from those very important words to one just quick reference. Are we overdoing this beat Navy thing over here, Andy? There's a tunnel dedicating to beating Navy.
And
if I go to Annapolis
am I going to have the same, running straight on into the same kind of competitive feeling about the Army?
Sure. If you look in the superintendent's house, what's it say on the
oh, there's Beat Navy again! This is where the superintendent lives.
The commandant's next door.
Oh, the commandant. What's the difference in the commandant and the superintendent?
Two stars.
Oh, I see.
The superintendent is the president of the university.
Right.
The commandant is the dean of men.
I see.
Or dean of cadets here.
Is there anyone who has a stronger identification with the Corps than the man that we're going to see right here, Douglas MacArthur?
No, sir. He represents West Point.
He represents West Point.
In so many aspects of West Point, yes. Our honor code, 1922, he codified it. He put it into practice. I don't think there's been a graduate with a greater influence in today's West Point than what General MacArthur had done in his time as an officer in the Army and also a superintendent.
He was, first of all, a devoted fan of Army football.
So he would have bought into all of this Beat Navy stuff.
And there was a story where, I mean, an incident. My junior year, he came up, and we happened to be having a preseason scrimmage against Syracuse. And MacArthur asked to speak to the team. He speaks to the team.
The team, right.
This was a scrimmage. This was a preseason scrimmage game to get ready for the season.
But he wanted to inspire you.
And he talked about, when you're on that field, you play not for yourself, not for the Army team, but for the ghosts of a million soldiers who laid down the... It was the most incredible thing. We tore out of the... The doors off the hinges went
Syracuse
out.
Syracuse said, what happened to those cadets?
The first three plays, we knocked a key Syracuse player out of the game. And this is a true story. And the Syracuse coach came over to Blake and said...
Blake would be Earl Red Blake.
Earl Red Blake said, Red, what's going on?
It's a scrimmage.
We're trying to get ready for the season, and you're demolishing us. And Blake said, I was standing right beside him, he said, there's nothing I can do. MacArthur talked to the team.
But speaking for a moment, we'll come back to MacArthur. Coach Blake was a mentor for you.
Vince Lombardi, in his autobiography, says, everything I ever learned about football, I learned from Red Blake at West Point. Blake had this MacArthurian quality about him. In fact, they were very close. Behind Coach Blake's desk was a larger-than-life-size painting of Douglas MacArthur.
Waiting ashore in the Philippines? Or?
Blake even began to sound like MacArthur. I'm not fooling you. And I remember when you got called in to see Coach Blake, and you walked across this large office to this giant desk, all the while staring at Douglas MacArthur, staring back at you, you got smaller and smaller and smaller.
Yeah, but as we look at the great man, due to honor and country, the three hallowed words, you know, this is, I assume, part of the great speech. That's right. Right, Andy?
This is his duty, honor, country speech. This is his address to the Corps, his parting address to the Corps. And he talked about West Point and what it meant to him and how it provided faith when there seemed to be little cause for faith. He told us what West Point, he told the Corps what West Point meant to him. And through the things he accomplished, he gave us all an identity in what West Point should mean to us.
You have responsibilities this morning to other cadets. I wish you well, and I thank you for taking the time to help us come here and take note of the 200th birthday of West Point, the home of the U.S. Military Academy.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Our best to your fellow cadets. The West Point of Dawkins' time is a far different place than the West Point of today, and the most important difference is women.
I'd love to begin by having you tell me your name and where you're from and what class you're in.
Good morning, sir. Good morning. My name is Cadet Raven Bukowski. I'm from Akron, Ohio, and I'm a second-class cadet.
My name's Marietta Squire, and I grew up around the D.C. area.
My name is Marcia Reyes, and I grew up mostly in New Hampshire.
What year?
I'm a second class cadet, so junior.
So you're junior.
Right.
Hi, Charlie. I am Nancy Perkins. I'm from El Paso, Texas, and I am a first classman, so I'll be graduating this year.
Do you know where you'll be going?
For my officer basic course, I'll be going to Fort Leavenworth, Missouri.
Okay. I'm Bree Millard. I'm a second class cadet also, so a junior, and I'm from Massachusetts.
Now, juniors are also cows, right?
Yes.
That's what we also call juniors.
Cows. For, that's very complimentary.
Any of you, why did you come to West Point? Why the U.S. Military Academy?
Well, I knew that this was the premier leadership institution, and I knew that in my life I wanted to become the best leader that I could, and I chose the profession of officership. And so by coming here, I knew I'd be getting the best training in that field, in my chosen profession.
And I should take note of the fact that you are the number one in terms of the military.
Right.
Number one in your class.
Right.
Period. It's a pretty good honor.
Yes, it is.
Congratulations.
Very big honor. Thank you.
Okay. So you're in line to be, Pete, help me if I'm right about this, she's in line to be first
captain.
Captain.
Right.
If things continue to work out that way? Now, would that be the first woman who's been first captain?
No, there has been one prior.
Okay. Why'd you come here?
I've always wanted to come to West Point, ever since I was a child.
Family reason, just...
No, not at all. Long before I knew there was any sort of military affiliation, I had always wanted to come here. I remember when I was about 8 or 9, my mother being very impressed with the school and being that the fact that she didn't speak English and had just moved to the country from Korea, that had always impacted my impression of it, that it had made such an impression on her.
Well, Charlie, I had always been considering a career in government service, perhaps in the State Department, something of that sort. And I thought that coming to West Point and having the leadership training and educational and service experience as an officer in the Army could really help me out as a precursor to that career in government service. But as I found since I've been here, I really love the Army, and that's where I see myself staying.
How many of you think you'll be in the Army 10 years after you graduate? Or can you say that?
I think I will.
You do?
Mm-hmm.
You do? You do? Mm-hmm. You don't know?
I don't know.
No, you'll find out.
It's a good possibility.
You'll
find out. I'm going to stay in as long as I have fun, sir.
You have fun.
And so, you know.
There was one of you, and I think it was you, that saw an article about the Beast. Was that you?
Right.
What is that?
I read this article in the New York Times magazine about Beast Barracks, which is when the new cadets come in, they teach them how to salute and different things like that. And so I read it. I was like, whoa, that sounds like a challenge. I want to do that.
You said to me that the presence of female cadets is probably the most important change in this institution, certainly in the last 25 years, 50 years.
Yeah, I really believe that. I'd be interested in your feelings of it being part of it, but it's certainly the most obvious difference between the West Point I was at 40 years ago from here. And I think it was, first of all, I think it was exactly the right thing to do. This is a national institution, and you know, as we have, as a country, as a society, worked toward kind of gender equality, I'm very proud of the fact that the military, it seems to me, has been a leader in this. And while there were a lot of challenges have been in working through all the complexities of it here, my observation is that it's gone very well, and I'm very proud of how this opportunity has been made available. I believe, you tell me, on a really equal basis. I mean, you compete with your male counterparts.
Very good question.
And
what, any difference because of your gender in terms of what you do and don't do and any of that kind of thing? No?
No.
You march as long, you have all the same requirements and everything else.
There's very little differences. During the academic year, we have Department of Physical Education courses. The men will take boxing, but everyone will take swimming. They are integrating the wrestling program to involve women, and they call it a grappling course. Everyone takes a hand-to-hand combat course.
Right.
The main differences are the ones that are consistent with the Army, being the physical standards, because there are biological differences.
Sure.
So the Army physical fitness test accounts for those differences, but also accounts for differences in age. So it's not just gender-oriented.
Okay. any problems being a female cadet? Any issues? Anything? It's working okay.
It's working just fine.
Now here's your chance. Now, but this assimilation, it's now been since 1976. Assimilation works here at West Point. Yes?
I would say, like, there really aren't too many differences. Like, for the most part, after a while, because you live with people, and when you're, like, last summer when we were at Camp Buckner, and you're just covered in dirt, and you haven't taken a shower in 5 days, right. And you smell so bad. I mean, it gets to the point where, like, you don't even care.
If you had to do it over, you'd do it again?
Oh, absolutely.
Absolutely. It's been that kind of rewarding experience for all of you. Definitely. In terms of...
And you know, Charlie, I think it's also had an impact, a very important impact on the academy, not just on the female cadets, women cadets, but the academy. I really believe, now this is my belief, that we've changed the way we teach leadership, and that a significant part of that transformation was because of women coming here. It was ironic, but in 1976 in the spring, there was a major cheating scandal, and about 190 cadets were let go. And then in the summer, the women came. And what that combination of things did was it triggered a reassessment of how leadership was being taught. And out of that, the old fourth class system, you know, where everyone was sort of hazed the plebes, was transformed into a four class system. And leadership began to be taught positively. It's sort of the second generation of the golden rule.
Sure.
Treat the people who work for you as you would like to be treated. And that transformation has been immensely powerful for the Army, for the military, not just for West Point and not just for women at West Point. But I think it's been a unanticipated positive consequence.
Do you feel, from looking at this institution, that somehow you can feel the impact that women may have had on the place?
None of us were here for the change, so maybe we don't see how it was before. We concentrate much more on building up leaders, building up the new cadets that we bring in, rather than breaking them down. So it's really just such a positive form of leadership.
And that's exactly, you know, Pete's point.
Exactly what he's saying. Yeah. So I wasn't here to see the change, but I think how we do leadership now is just phenomenal.
In the summer, what do you do?
We train.
You train.
While all
train.
Of our while our peers are at, you know, Virginia Beach and off in Europe, we're in the mud doing military training, or we're off jumping out of airplanes.
We went to Air Force School together this summer. Mm-hmm.
Do you choose majors? Yeah. This is my own. You do.
Yeah.
So your major is?
I'm a chemistry major.
Law major.
Law major.
No.
Chemistry, too.
Chemistry.
International relations.
A diplomat amongst. Uh-huh. You know. When you think about the future, in terms of the kinds of things that have happened to you, what's been the best experience for you that you think has influenced who you are and what you want to be in your life at West Point?
Charlie, I'd have to say by far the best experience I've had here was this past summer being a platoon sergeant for the first part of Beast Barracks.
Yeah.
I had about 40 new cadets
underneath
my charge.
Yeah.
And it was just great to develop them and challenge them and see how they came to meet those challenges and develop into the young leaders. That they
put in practice some of the leadership things that you have learned here.
Precisely.
Yeah. You have had to have, to be achieve the rank that you have, certain skills. I mean, what is it you think is that you have been able to employ that's led to this distinction for you?
I guess that we can attribute that to what leadership attributes, you know, a person has. And
right.
For me, I think that I'm able to lead by example in everything I do. And in the three pillars that the program is built upon here, academics, physically, and military. So those three areas, you know, I think because I'm doing well in all three of them, I'm able to project an example for people to follow, someone to look to and say, okay, that's the way to go.
Any way you want to change West Point?
How much time do we have here?
I think so far, so good.
And to tell you the truth, I've only been here for close to 4 years. And what I've seen is kind of a backwards thing. We're going forwards, obviously. We're always progressing. But we always go back to the things that make sense, that always matter, that are consistently productive and effective.
These are values or experiences or what?
Pretty much everything, Charlie. The 7 honoring values and the 8 tenets of leadership are huge tools that we use, ideals that we just try to, how shall we say?
Put into action. There you go. Yeah.
Let me ask a different question. Do you ever feel, as women cadets, isolated, not from other cadets, but from the world outside? Or do you feel like you're missing out in anything by being here within the context of a cadet at the military academy?
The only thing I would say is perhaps missing that college life that a lot of older people seem to say, oh, my good old college years, going out with your friends, having a beer on a Tuesday or Thursday night isn't something that we as cadets can do, but it's not something because we're females, it's just because we're cadets.
Right. Is there anything you don't think you can dream?
Not at all. Not here. Yeah.
Not to think about that one.
Okay.
I think you learn so much by going through all the things, the learning experiences you do here, that you don't have limits. I think that's one of the things that they try to show you. You know, you don't have physical limits, you don't have mental limits. You know, you're constantly learning and you're becoming better, whatever it is that better is for you.
One of the things that that I do think is a positive about this place is that there's a tolerance of making mistakes. At least my recollection is of that. And so if you really do something dumb, presuming it's not malicious, people are very tolerant of it. And the other part of it was, and I'm going to ask you, we had a tremendous amount of good times as cadets. People have this view, I think, that West Point is a sort of monastic place. Everyone is totally serious-minded. Mm-hmm. They're all mission-oriented.
Mm-hmm. All they do is salute and say, yes, sir, yes, ma'am.
And the truth is, this is a bunch of college. This is 4,000 college kids. There are pranks galore moment by moment, and people really...
So you're getting traditionally understand to be a university experience.
I think so. One of the best examples of that is the diversity of the cadet clubs and organizations we have. In addition to about every competitive varsity college sport that we offer, we have cheerleaders. I'm one. We have a theater group, we have a glee club, various church choirs, rock climbing, fencing, you name it, we have it. We have literature forums, movie club, various cultural groups. So there's no limit to the things that you can get involved in here, and it's so much fun. There's too many things on my plate because I want to be involved in so many organizations.
Thank you all, and much success to you. It's really an honor for me, and I'm sure I speak for Pete as well, to meet you and to see the future of the United States Army right here in front of us. So thank you very much, and much success.
Thank you.
Great to have you on this program.
Thank you.
And when we come back, we'll go talk to the superintendent and get a picture of this place from his perspective. Stay with us. Douglas MacArthur, William Westmoreland, Maxwell Taylor. Their portraits hang in the office of the superintendent, the president of the university. All were graduates of West Point and served as superintendent. In recent years, it is the last position an individual holds in the Army. I spoke to Lieutenant General William J. Lennox, Jr., the 56th superintendent. What impact, General Lennox, did September 11th have on this institution?
September 11th had quite an impact. The cadets felt it. They're young leaders. They wanted to do something. Unfortunately, there was very little they could do. I had to talk to them in the mess hall. I told them, really, they were the leaders of the future. A little tactical patience was needed right now. They went out on their own. They gave blood. They gathered money to help out down there. Broader than that, I think it had an impact on people's understanding of what we are. We're celebrating our bicentennial this year, and one of the graduates asked me, are we going to continue celebrating the bicentennial during this time, right after the tragedy? And I said, yes, we are, because America and West Point have been together through the ups and downs, through the years, peace and war. And I can think of no better time than to celebrate West Point and America during this year.
What's the mission?
The mission of the Military Academy is to produce leaders of character for the Army and for the nation.
Has that mandate changed in terms of the way you carry it out?
It has not changed. The focus is still there, big picture. We're producing leaders for the nation. We want to produce leaders that are broadly educated. I think we're on target there. We made some small adjustments, bringing in some professors that were experts in the Middle East. We may have a chair on anti-terrorism. These kinds of things we can add on to our core curriculum without any problem. In our physical and our military, I think we're on target. So I think in a broad sense, West Point has been marching along and doing a pretty good job in keeping up with what's needed.
I ask that because West Point is, you know, a training ground for future leaders of America, clearly, and obviously the military. But leaders leave the military and go on in other areas, and business and academics. And to look at your list of people who have had distinction in other areas is remarkable, from a neurosurgeon here to a corporate president to a university president to all kinds of things. And many go on to be Rhodes Scholars. But the demands on leadership in this century is different. And the military increasingly is carrying on a more proactive role around the world.
Yeah, you're exactly right. One person mentioned that the special forces in Afghanistan were part Harvard professor and part Chicago mobster. I think I'd rephrase that a little bit if I were describing the kind of soldier and military leader we're going to need in the future. It's probably going to be part Harvard professor, part professional athlete, maybe part international ambassador, and all warfighter. And that's what we're...
But the point is, whether it's a Chicago mobster or something else, it is this idea that you have to be able to exist within the environment that you find yourself. You got to know them, you got to understand them, you got to speak their language, and you got to be able to connect.
You're exactly right. I just think back to the conditions our special forces saw when they entered Afghanistan. They just carried their own moral ethical framework, the knowledge they had, their physical capabilities, and probably the shirts on their backs, and were given missions in that ambiguous environment to link up with forces, to help arm them, and in fact move with them as they fought their way into Kabul. Just amazing. That's the kind of leader I think we're going to need in the future.
Leaders who are not only warriors, but peacemakers.
Exactly. People who can function in an ambiguous environment, get mission orders, and then get into an environment where they have to set their own framework and work through that framework to accomplish the mission.
You teach leadership here.
Yes, sir.
How do you do that?
That's a great question. We've been examining that a little bit ourselves over the last few years. One of the things we do is provide cadets opportunities for leadership through 47 months. And we put them in an environment where they've got to take charge. And then we give them feedback as to what occurred when they were in charge. And I think that's the best way to do it. During the regular academic year, they have a chain of command. They've got to function in that chain of command. During the summers, they're all over the world. Some of them are platoon leaders out with regular Army platoons. Some of them function right here in the training environment at West Point. Some of them are on visits to Uzbekistan or countries all over the world, getting to know those other armies and carrying those lessons learned back here to the academy.
I look around me and I see some of the people who've sat at your desk.
Robert E. Lee, the great Southern general, who the North wanted to command its troops, and because of a love of Virginia, he chose the Southern command. Douglas MacArthur.
Sure.
It goes on and on. I mean, this, you set with huge responsibilities to lead this place, because the Army has chosen some of its best to come here.
Yes, sir. As I look around the office here, I have 55 former superintendents helping me every single day.
You look up for inspiration, for guidance?
I do.
A remembrance of duty, honor, and country?
I do. And I also have done reading and understand that West Point has changed. Each one of these superintendents has been responsible at a given point in the nation's history to produce those leaders. And they've done certain things to accommodate that time and change the academy to fit that environment that they know that their young lieutenants are going to go out into. And that's the strength that I feel from these folks. They've done those things before, and I can get a little bit of support from these men.
Even though we have touched on it, enlarge on the idea of how you see the challenge for General Lennox in 2002 as this place celebrates its bicentennial.
Great. I see a number of challenges. The first one during the bicentennial, I'd like to tell the West Point story to the American people. Tell about the history, the great leaders who have graduated from this institution. Talk about the beginnings when we thought we were graduating engineers and artillerists and subsequently graduating presidents and great generals and CEOs. Talk about the Civil War with the Lees and Grants and the out of the 60 significant battles in the Civil War, 55 of those battles had West Pointers leading both sides. Five had West Pointers leading one side. Gothels, who built the Panama Canal. Pershing in World War I and MacArthur and Eisenhower in World War II. The Schwarzkopfs and Wesley Clarks of today. The astronauts, Borman and White. I can go on and on, but there's a tremendous leadership that have come out of this academy, and that's the story we want to tell. More than that, we want to look to the future. We want to look to the next 200 years and continue that leadership that the point has given to the nation and to the Army, and want to tell that story so that people understand what West Point's all about.
Well, your background is interesting. I mean, you're a guy who got a PhD.
Yes, sir.
In literature.
Yes, sir.
And you wrote your dissertation on American war poetry.
Yes, sir.
A lot of poetry come out of war?
It sure does. I think there was a great description of what goes on for an infantryman in one of the books that I read, saying that our infantrymen have trouble articulating what goes on in a battle. And poetry sometimes is their outlet. And whether it's fear or trying to understand the situation they're placed in, or the bravery that some of the men exhibit, just fascinating.
There's been no more significant change at West Point than women.
Yes, sir.
Certainly in the last...
Probably correct.
Last 25 years. I mean,
yes, sir.
Without even worrying about what might be close second, say, let's assume that in the last 25 years, it's women came here in 1976. What impact has the inclusion of women had?
I think if you ask some of the older grads, they'd say everything has changed. I'd go back to the mission. We're producing leaders of character for the nation and the Army, and that's exactly what we're doing. There's been a change in the Army. Women have been included to even a greater extent. About 17% of the Army, women. About 17.
Both the officers and enlisted.
Yes, and about 17% of the cadets here at West Point are women. They have come in beautifully. There is no problem with what they do. In fact, they're all stars in a number of the areas. Sometimes. I'd say it's probably even a little bit tougher for them to get into the academy because there are more women applying proportionally than men. And we are probably a little more selective in those that come in. A I think it's a third of the women participate in intercollegiate sports, about a fifth of the men. So they fit in very well.
How have women infected the way, the curriculum you teach, and the way you go about the business at West Point?
We've had to make some changes to our curriculum early, our physical curriculum. For example, the men box, women take combatives.
Sure.
So we've made some changes to that. It changes the barracks life, because now you have the women rooms integrated in with the company rooms. But other than that, I think that we have done a pretty good job in incorporating women. I'll tell you, it was tough for the women who first came in.
Because?
And I've just integrating into that all-male society. And I talked to some of the women from the earlier classes, and they have some mixed emotions. I think they love the academy. I think they value the experience they went through. I think they feel some pain that maybe they were confronted by some of the classmates who didn't think they ought to be there. I don't think that happens anymore. Right now, I think the women are pretty well accepted into the Corps. Now, if you ask me, are there individuals out there who resent it, I'd say yes. But I think that as they go through the 4 years and see the contributions the women make, we change their mind.
You've had a woman as captain of the cadets.
Yes, sure have. We have women are incorporated into the chain of command. This is a fully integrated society in that regard. One of our regimental commanders right now is a woman. It's in that regard the same as having a man in that position.
What's the difference in what happens at the military academy, at the U.S. military academy here on the Hudson, and the U.S. Naval Academy in Annapolis, and the U.S. Air Force Academy in Colorado? I mean, are they teaching the same thing, or is there a difference?
I think there are some differences. I think America can be proud that they've got three great academies. I think that that's just tremendous. You have young men and women graduating from each of them. Absolutely great. That said, I do think that there is more of a technical bent, maybe at the Air Force Academy. They deal with the machinery, the technology a little bit more than we do. I'll tell you, we are fully focused on leadership. We think that is extremely important. The Army is people. We may advance
the Army is people.
The Army is people. And that leadership is so key. When those young lieutenants hit their first platoon, that is all they have, is their leadership capability. And that's what we want them to have. Our young lieutenants have got to be so aware of that and the responsibility they carry, because they're leaders of America's sons and daughters. And we've got to make sure that they're ready to do that.
How long do you expect to stay here?
So our normal tour is about 4 years. So I've got about three more.
Do you have specific goals to accomplish while you're here?
Yes, sir.
You're doing more than just a caretaker.
You're exactly right. I want to do the same thing that I saw, that I see in the histories around me. I think
each man reacting to his own time.
I think that each superintendent reacts to a couple things. He reacts to the environment that he sees that these leaders will go into. He looks 10, 20 years out. Chief of Staff of the Army told me before I took this job that a Chief of Staff of the Army influences the Army for maybe 4 or 5 years after his term.
Because he sets in motion things.
That's exactly right. Superintendent influences it 10, 20, even 30 years, because he's dealt with these young people. So I'm cognizant of that. And I have to be very aware of that, as I think these other superintendents were. So I want to make sure that the processes here in the academy are attuned to that, so that we have fantastic leadership coming out of here for years to come.
What one quality do you want these young men and women to leave with?
I think the quality of leaders of character.
Character.
That's what I want, leaders of character. Those that understand the moral framework they operate in, understand leadership, and can function as a platoon leader, and then eventually maybe Chief of Staff of the Army or even President. Yeah.
We'll certainly see a woman as superintendent.
Probably.
Well, certainly, probably.
Probably. We'll probably see, in the near future.
We'll certainly see a woman as chief of staff.
I think eventually, yes.
And, of course, as president, as commander-in-chief.
Yes.
When you look at all the things that are happening here, what, other than September 11th, what kinds of things are influencing this community?
Oh, there are lots of things and influences. Of course, as I said, looking out to the future, trying to divine exactly what we're going to need in the future.
Right.
But there's pushes and tugs. We have the Long Gray Line, our alumni,
right.
And they have their ideas of the way West Point ought to go, and I listen to them, and then make some decisions. I have the Army, I have Congress, I have lots of people who help me, and they're, for the most part, the advice is very, very good, and we function in that environment.
General Lennox, thank you for allowing us to visit with you here in this place, and also to be here on this, on the hallowed grounds of West Point.
Sir, thanks for being here.
Thank you. After leaving the superintendent's office, I caught up with Pete Dawkins again for one last time for a visit to the statue of West Point's most famous warrior, George S. Patton, famous because of his exploits in World War II, as well as an Academy Award-winning movie starring George C. Scott.
I love it. God help me, I do love it so. I love it more than my life.
We're standing here now at the end of a day in front of a statue of General George S. Patton, class of 1909. Your favorite statue?
My favorite statue.
Why?
Well, a couple of reasons. I mean, when you look at it, first of all, I happen to think it's a extraordinarily graphic piece of sculpture.
Yeah. Looks like a soldier.
Looks like a soldier. Looks like a warrior.
Yeah.
And it's bigger than life, and General Patton was bigger than life. There is an irony that he's facing the library.
Not known
as a great scholar.
Yeah.
But it's never too late to learn, maybe the lesson of that. But in many respects, at the soul and the core of what this academy is about, is a warrior ethic. The mission of this institution, we need to remember, is to fight the country's wars. It's to build leaders of character who can win on the battlefield and protect this country. And if there ever was a pure warrior, someone who in every element of his DNA and every aspect of his personality was the consummate leader of soldiers in combat, it was George Patton.
Tell me again why you wanted to come to West Point.
I wanted to come to West Point simply because my high school football coach persuaded me that it was the best place for me. I came with some uncertainty and left with the total knowledge that this was the right place for me to have been. And there's no question but that it transformed my life.
How did it transform your life?
I learned how to aspire to lead, but to learn to follow. I learned how together the power of what a real team is. And I think I got imbued with the aspiration to win at whatever you do, to set your sights not on some modest level, but to really want to achieve. And probably most importantly of all, in some curious way, I don't know how it happens, I came away with a sense of being part of something bigger than I am, bigger than I was, and the attractiveness and the allure and the satisfaction of doing something not for yourself, but for the enduring goodness of a great organization and a great institution.
West Point, served your country, and retired at 43, one of the youngest generals at that time. Do you have any regrets about leaving this service that had meant so much to you and you had honored by achievement?
I have no regrets at all. I mean, my fundamental belief in life is that you look out through the windshield, not in the rearview mirror. I left with great reservations because I loved what I was doing. My career was flourishing. I had just been selected to take Colin Powell's place as the military assistant to the Secretary of Defense. And I wanted to do all of those things. But I had become just aware that you can't do everything in life. And by choosing to do one thing, you necessarily cannot do something else.
Staying in the Army, you would have cut off other options that presented themselves.
Surely, I mean, that's the fact. And I just felt that there were other opportunities. I felt that maybe, probably incorrectly, that during my lifetime, the key decisions having to do with national security were going to be made by people out of uniform, not those in uniform.
In political life.
I really had aspirations of being able to be involved in public life in some other fashion that would not have been possible if I had remained in uniform.
Now, whatever we say about you as a human being, values that are central to who you are were shaped right here on these grounds.
I had, you know, such a fortunate time of being at a number of places. Here at Oxford, at Princeton, with great people. All of those have made immense contributions to my life, but no place left an indelible imprint the way this place did, and always will.
Pete Dawkins, thank you for taking us to West Point. Thank you for being part of this remarkable place we have come to visit as they celebrate their bicentennial, a place that's seen so many people come here and go on to serve their country, a place that's known a range of personalities and heroes, something that's been part of the American spirit for a long, long time. They train leaders here, and a country that plays such an extraordinary role in the world today needs all the leaders that it can find in a world that is dangerous, more dangerous perhaps than it's ever been because the enemy is less seen. We thank you for taking this journey with us to West Point and the U.S. Military Academy. See you next time.
Charlie Rose is made possible by these funders.
And by Bloomberg, a provider of multimedia news and information services worldwide.
To order Charlie Rose program transcripts and video cassettes, call 1-800-ALL-NEWS or write to the address on your screen. Please indicate show date and guest.
This is PBS.